Yes, a very good morning. Right, so let's discuss the MCQs in the RTP November 19. Already before this, there are six videos on MCQs which have been uploaded, which has all the MCQs which have been issued by ICAI so far. Right, so in that series, now let's add to it the MCQs in RTP November 19. Okay. Right, so yes. RBJ Limited, they write such a big story, but then that's helpful to us to write the theory part of the answers also. Right, is a listed company engaged in the business of software and was one of the largest company operating in this sector in India. The company's annual turnover is 40,000 crore with profit of 5,000 crore. Due to the nature of the business and the size of the company, the operations of the company are spread out in India as well as outside India. Outside India, the company is focusing more on US and European markets, and the company has been able to establish its goods reputation in these markets as well. During the course of the audit team spends significant time on audit of revenue, be it planning, execution, or conclusion. The audit team for this engagement is generally very big, that is a team of approximately 70 to 80 members. The company's contracts with its various customers are quite complicated and different. The efforts towards audit of revenue also involve significant involvement of senior members of the audit team, including the audit partner. After completion of the audit for 2019, the audit partner was discussing significant matters with the management, wherein he also communicated to the management that he plans to include revenue recognition as a key audit matter in his audit report. The management was quite surprised to understand this from the auditor and did not agree with revenue recognition to be shown as key audit matter in the audit report. As per the management, the auditor did not have any modification, and such a matter getting reported as a key audit matter would not go down well with various stakeholders and would significantly impact the financial positions of the company in the market. The auditors were not able to convince the management in respect of this point, and there was a difference of opinion. You are requested to give your view in respect of this matter. Right, so what has happened in the question? It says that revenue recognition, it is a very complicated matter while doing the audit of the financial statements of this company, and that is why the auditor wants to put it in the audit report as a key audit matter. Right, key audit matter trending very much nowadays. Right, so now key audit matters are those matters that in the auditor's professional judgment were of most significance in the audit of the financial statements of the current period. Right, and they are selected from the matters communicated to TCWG. Right, so most significance, and it looks like yes, it was a matter of most significance in the audit of the financial statements. And how do you describe a key audit matter paragraph in your audit report? By mentioning why it is a key audit matter and also how it has been addressed. Right, why it is a key audit matter and also how it has been addressed. Right, now lately, you can see in the audit report of so many companies that there is a key audit matter paragraph in the audit report. Like, if I come to this annual report, audit report of SpiceJet, right, key audit matters, right? See, in the independent auditor's report, this is just for your knowledge, because now lately the auditors have started incorporating this key audit matter paragraph in the audit report. Right, so title, addressee, opinion, basis for opinion, emphasis of matter, key audit matter. Right, so were of most significance in the audit of the financial statements. These matters were described, and then key audit matter. Right, so what is the key audit matter and how our audit addressed the key audit matter? Right, so they are saying provision for aircraft maintenance. As at 31st March, the company operated 65 aircraft under operating leases, in respect of which the company has contractual, regulatory, or other constructive obligations for maintenance of the aircraft. Our audit procedure, the design, implementation, and the operating effectiveness. We evaluated the provisioning model. We discussed with the appropriate personnel in the engineering department responsible for aircraft engineering, and we assessed the maintenance costs incurred and provisions made in earlier years. So literally, the auditor is writing down ke what audit procedure will be performed to check for the provision for the aircraft maintenance. Right, the auditor says it was a very critical area. It was a very matter of most significance in the audit, checking the provision for the aircraft maintenance. So why it was a key audit matter and how it has been addressed. So they have one more, capitalization of aircraft maintenance and overhaul cost. Right, so again, why it is a key audit matter and then how it has been addressed in the audit. Then management's assessment of appropriateness of going concern assumption. This could have also come as a material uncertainty related to going concern para in the audit report. Right, so again, management's assessment, why it is a key audit matter and then what are our audit procedures. Right, we assess the timing of the various recurring and other events. We tested the arithmetical accuracy of the models. Right, we discuss with the management the assumptions, judgments and estimates made. Right, any potential restrictions on cash balances, management's cash flow forecast and the group disclosures regarding going concern in the financial statements. Right, so this is just an insight for you regarding actually how does a key audit matter paragraph come in the audit report. So now what has happened in this MCQ, they are saying that revenue auditor wants to put it in the audit report as a key audit matter, though it is not a modification and the management is objecting the same. So we need to look into what are the four options. Right, the concern of the management is valid. For a large size company, such type of matter getting reported as a key audit matter is not appropriate, absolutely wrong. The assessment of the auditor is valid, such a matter qualifies to be a key audit matter and hence should be reported accordingly by the auditor in his audit report, looks like okay. Reporting revenue as a key audit matter when the auditor does not have any observation in that area leading to any modification would not be appropriate, doesn't seem to be okay. Because we are not modifying, still we want to put in audit report, that is why we are putting it in key audit matter. Right, and this being the first year of reporting of key audit matter, the auditor should take a soft stand and should avoid reporting such controversial matters in the audit report, that is absolute filler. Right, so the correct option over here is going to be B. Right, next one. BDJ Limited is engaged in the business of providing management consultancy services and have been in operation for the last 15 years. The company's financial reporting process is very good and its statutory auditors always issued clean audit report on the audit of the financial statements of the company. The auditors were required to be rotated due to mandatory audit rotation requirement of Companies Act. RNG and Associates, a firm of CAs, was appointed as the new auditor of the company for a term of 5 years and have to start their first audit for the financial year 19. The auditors had a detailed and clear discussion with the management that they will perform their audit procedures in respect of opening balances along with the audit procedures for 2019. Management agreed with that and the audit plan was completed as per the audit was completed as per the plan. The auditors did not have any significant observations and hence they communicated to the management that their report will be clean. Management was quite happy with this and also requested the auditors to share draft report before issuing the final report. In the draft audit report, all the particulars were fine except other matter paragraph wherein the auditors gave a reference to that the financial statements for the comparative year 2018 was audited by another auditor. When I read this, it immediately reminds me of what we studied in SA 510, comparative information, reporting on comparative information. Prior period has been audited by predecessor auditor, other matter paragraph. That prior period has been audited by predecessor auditor, type of opinion and the date of report. That's a requirement of SA 710. And in addition to that, you also follow the requirements of SA 510, initial audit engagements, opening balances. Management asked the audit team to remove this paragraph as the auditors had planned all, performed all the audit procedures on opening balances also. But the auditors did not agree with the management. Please advise the auditor or the management, whoever is incorrect, with the right guidance. Okay, the contention of the management is valid. After performing the procedures, the auditor should not pass on the responsibility to another auditor. We are not passing on the responsibility. We are just clarifying that prior period was audited by predecessor auditor. Any auditor has two options, either to perform the procedures or give such reference to another auditor in his report. An auditor cannot mix up the things like this auditor has done. It is completely unprofessional. So much creativity on the part of the person who prepares the options for the MCQ. Right. In the given situation, even if the auditor wants to give such a reference, the management and the auditor should have taken approval from the previous auditor at the time of appointment of the new auditor. In this case, it cannot be done. And let's read the last one. The report of the auditor is absolutely correct and is in line with the auditing standards. An auditor is required to include such a reference in his report as per the requirements of the auditing standard, right? So D is the correct option, right? That's the requirement of SE 710, comparative information, corresponding figures and comparative financial statements. I hope you're awake. Right, next one. KJ Private Limited is engaged in the business of e-commerce, wherein most of the operations are automated. The company has SAP as its ERP package and is planning to upgrade the SAP version. Currently, the version of SAP being used is fine, but the higher version would lead to increased efficiencies, and hence the company is considering this plan, which will also involve a huge outlay. KPP and Associates were appointed as the statutory auditors of this company for 2019, and the stat audit firm has been working in this industry for long, but most of the work which the firm did was more of risk advisory or internal audit. For the first time, this audit will be conducted, and that's why the audit team started obtaining understanding of the operations of the company, which included understanding of the SAP system of the company, right? As a part of KOC, also understanding SAP. However, the management of the company was not comfortable with this approach of the audit team, particularly because audit team was spending good time on understanding the IT systems of the company. The management suggested that the auditor should limit their understanding and should perform audit procedures rather than getting into business operations. But the auditors have a different view on this matter, and because of which work has got stuck. In the given situation, please suggest what should be the course of action. Right, the approach of the audit team to obtain detailed understanding of the company before starting with the audit procedures is absolutely fine. If the auditors don't understand the system properly, the audit procedures may not be appropriate. Yes, that seems to be the correct one. Right, if you don't understand the entity, you won't be able to assess RMM and then do TOC and then substantive. Okay, right, then the management's concern regarding the approach of the auditor seems reasonable. The auditors are spending time on understanding of the system business and not performing their audit procedures. No, this is not right. This being a private company and that too into the business of e-commerce, the auditor should have knowledge about the operations of the company through their understanding of the industry, and hence should not get into this process of obtaining detailed understanding at the client place. No. The audit team could have planned their work differently. They should involve IT experts who would have knowledge of the systems of the company, and hence lot of time can be saved. Further, in such type of an industry, involvement of IT experts is anyways required mandatorily as per the legal requirement. First part seemed okay, but then where did the second part come, saying that involvement of IT experts is anyways required mandatorily as per legal requirement? There's no legal requirement for taking the help of an expert, right? So even this one is not the correct option, right? So the correct option is A, right? That's absolutely fine. And if the auditors don't understand the system properly, the audit procedures may not be appropriate. Okay, right? So that is the third one. Right, Yuvraj Limited is an NBFC other than a Nidhi company and is covered by the NBFC Directions 2016. The NBFC has been in existence for last 11 years and its operations are considerable in size, having a net worth of 299 crore. The new NBFC has new statutory auditors. The audit report of NBFC was clean for the financial year 18. The company had a planning discussion with the auditors of the company for 2019, who raised a point regarding the applicability of the new set of AS, Ind AS, on the NBFC for 2019. So NBFC Ind AS not applicable up to 2019. And I've asked the management to ensure that its financial statement should be according to that. This comes as a big surprise to the management, who had assessed that Ind AS would not be applicable to this NBFC because of the fact that Karu is applicable on this NBFC. There is a big disconnect on this matter between the auditor and the management. Please help by resolving the matter. Both the management and statutory auditors are not correct because Ind AS is not applicable to any NBFC. Management is correct because Ind AS is applicable only to NBFC, which are also a Nidhi company. In this case, Karo being applicable, Ind AS cannot apply. No such link. If the management does not agree with the view of the statutory auditors, then they should give adverse opinion and in their report and also report this to RBI. Too harsh. Right? This is too harsh. Right, and Ind AS would not be applicable for 2019, and hence the view of the statutory auditors is not correct. Right, Ind AS would not be applicable for 2019. So finally, now the management is correct, because 2019 NBFC's Ind AS not applicable, and hence the view of the management is correct, and the view of the statutory auditors is not correct. Okay, next one. Shitij and a group of persons subscribed to the shares of JNN. JNN had issued a prospectus for issuance of shares, against which shares have persons have subscribed to the shares. It was later found out that some information as included in the prospectus was misleading. These persons filed a case against the auditor covering all the parties who were responsible for the prospectus on the ground that the information contained in the prospectus was misleading. Reminds me of the chapter of liabilities of auditor, untrue statement in prospectus, damages for negligence. And they suffered losses because we say no damages without losses by relying on that information. The company consulted this matter with its legal consultants in respect of the course of action to be taken, and also consulted that if the outcome of the case goes against the company, then which all parties may be held liable and what could be the other consequences. The prospectus included auditor's report, who had also given his clearance. Some of the experts were also involved in respect of the information on which the litigation was filed. Subsequently, it was proved that contention of Shitij and those persons was correct. It was held that the directors, promoters of the company and the experts involved, so expert includes the chartered accountant also, would be liable to pay compensation to all these persons who had sustained losses or any damages. The auditors of the company were also asked to make good the losses, but they refused with an argument that it is limited to directors, promoters and experts. But what did I tell you? Experts includes the accountants, the chartered accountant. In this context, please suggest which one of the following statement is correct. The argument of the auditor is valid. As per the final outcome of the litigation, the auditors were not held liable. However, on moral grounds, the auditor should contribute towards the losses suffered by any person. There is no morality involved over here. Right, the argument of the auditor is valid. Since the final outcome of the litigation did not held them liable, they cannot be asked to contribute towards the losses suffered by any person. Next one, the argument of the auditor is not valid. The final outcome of the litigation covers the experts, and hence the auditor also gets covered to contribute towards the losses suffered by the persons. And the outcome of the litigation seems to be completely wrong. The directors and the experts who were held liable, but along with the statutory auditors, internal auditor, tax auditor, company secretary, tax consultant, legal advisor, should also have been held liable. Further, the promoters cannot be held liable in such matter. I am wrong, wrong, wrong. How promoters are the first one you will catch hold of. Okay, right, so the argument of the auditor is not valid. C is the correct option. The final outcome of the litigation covers the experts, and hence the auditors also get covered to contribute towards the losses suffered by the persons. Okay, right, that is 5. Next one, the audit of Selby and Company is at the last stage, where your team member is looking at the presentation of the item in the financial statements. You have instructed the team members to follow the general instructions given under Schedule 3, right, for the preparation and presentation of the financial statements. The team members have shown you the following list where the members have not adhered to the general instructions given in Schedule 3. Which of the following from the list is not as per Schedule 3? Is not as per Schedule 3. Right, the company had 32,500 in deferred tax liability and 12,500 in deferred tax asset. Deferred tax asset and deferred tax liability, if a company has both of them, you have to show the net, something like provision for tax and advance tax. The financial statements include both the above figures at non-current liabilities and non-current assets respectively. I think in the first one only we've caught the rotten tooth. Okay, right, the company had a loss in the current year, right, but we should obviously read all the others. The company had a loss in the current year. This debit balance of profit and loss account has been shown as a negative figure under the head surplus in the notes to financial statements, right? So this is right. So that is why this is nothing wrong. That is why for this is right. So that what is the question? It says which of the following is not as per Schedule 3. So which is not as per Schedule 3? The first one. Is this as per Schedule 3? Yes. Okay. In the current year, the company had issued a performance guarantee and a counter guarantee, but these were not disclosed as contingent liability in the notes in the financial statements. Right? So had issued a performance guarantee and a counter guarantee. So has not been disclosed as a contingent liability. Okay. Right? It could be shown separately. The company has clubbed all other expenses under the head other expenses on the basis of 1% of revenue from operations or 1 lakh, whichever is higher, to be disclosed separately. Right, so 1 lakh, with that has to be shown separately. Below that, they all have to be clubbed under other expenses or the miscellaneous expenses. Right, so which is the incorrect one over here? Right, which is the incorrect? The company had 32,500 in deferred tax liability and 12,500 in deferred tax asset. This should have been shown as net and not as gross. Right, so that is why A is the correct option. Right, coming to the seventh one, VKPL and Associates, a firm of chartered accountants, have been operating for the last 5 years, having its office in Gurgaon. The firm has staff of around 25 persons with 3 partners. The firm has been offering statutory audit, risk advisory, tax services to its various clients. The major work of the firm is for taxation services. The audit partners also discuss that the firm needs to work significantly to improve the quality of the services they offer, and that would also help the firm to grow its business. Considering this objective, the firm started training programs for the staff, which were made mandatory to be attended. During one of the training programs on quality, a topic was discussed regarding the information that should be obtained from the firm before accepting an engagement with a new client or when deciding whether to continue an existing engagement and considering acceptance of a new engagement with an existing client. Right? SQC 1, acceptance, continuance of client relationship. It was explained that the following points may assist the engagement partner in determining whether the conclusions reached regarding the acceptance, continuance of client relationship and audit engagements are appropriate. Integrity of principal owners, key management and TCWG of the entity, qualification of all the employees of the entity, whether the engagement team is competent to perform the engagement and has the necessary capability including time and resources, the remuneration offered by the entity to its various consultants, whether the firm and the engagement team can comply with the relevant ethical requirements, and significant matters that have arisen during the current or previous audit engagement and their implications for continuing the relationship. Right, we would like to understand from you which of the above mentioned points are relevant for the topic under discussion or not. Right, so this is clearly a question picked up from SQC 1 and SA 220 regarding what are the considerations for the auditor while accepting or continuing a client relationship. So first thing, as management checks for auditor integrity, auditor says, first thing, I will also check for your integrity. Right, the integrity of the principal owners, key management and TCWG of the entity. Qualification of all the employees of the entity while accepting continuing a client doesn't seem to be okay. Whether the engagement team is competent to perform the engagement and has the necessary capabilities, time and resources. Obviously, we need to check that before we accept or continue a client. The remuneration offered by the entity to its various consultants. Now, why do you want to check what is the remuneration paid to all consultants? No. Whether the firm and the engagement team can comply with the relevant ethical requirements. Because if you can't comply with ethical requirements, no accepting continuing the client. And significant matters that have arisen during the audit, current or previous audit engagement, and their implications for continuing the relationship. Like last year you issued adverse, or you put an emphasis of matter, or issued a disclaimer. So the effect on continuing the relationship. Right. So point number 2 and 4 not coming, that they've added on their own. Right. So which one should be the correct answer? 1, 3, 5 and 6. So let's see any A, B, C, D, which is 1, 3, 5, 6. Right. So the D option, that is 1, 3, 5, 6. Right. 1, 3, 5 and 6. Is that clear to everyone? Right. 1, 3 and then 5 and 6. Right. So D is the correct option. Right. 3 more to go. Right. AOP Private Limited is currently engaged in closing its books of account for 2019. The company has always been a compliance savvy and has also engaged consultants for the same. The business of the company has been stable over the years and profitability has been good over the last 3 years. The company got registered for GST on time. Since registration, the company has been filing statements of returns in GSTR 3B. However, annual return in GSTR 9 has not been filed by the company. Proper officer issued a notice for failure to file the annual return within 15 days. Even then, no annual return was filed by the company within the time permitted. Please advise. Right, so GSTR 9 has not been filed by the company. So in such a case, the company becomes a non-filer. In such a case, the company would remain fully compliant out. And the first option to go out is this one. How can it be fully compliant? The proper officer would be required to discuss this matter with the GST auditor of the company. Now, no, the company has to file. Why GST auditor coming? And GST auditor may resign in this situation. Now, that is not the question about. So, in such a case, the company has become a non-filer, right? As GSTR 9 has not been filed even after the notice has been received by the company. Right. Question number 9. NIC Private Limited is a large private company engaged in the business of insurance for the last 9 years. The company has expanded its business considerably over the years and have set up various divisions across India. The accounting and the operational systems of the company are centralized, wherein the accounts of all the division trial balance and their balance sheets are prepared by the head office. AG and company, a firm of CAs, are the statutory auditors of this company and audit all the divisions and the head office. The auditors have completed the audit for 2019 and the company's financial statements are approved. Before the AGM of the company received a notice from IRDAI which has asked the company to respond within 7 days as to why this company breached the requirement of IRDA guideline by having a single auditor for all the divisions and the head office. The management of the company has been doing so for years and were never aware of this requirement. To respond to this, the management has consulted many legal experts and also the auditors. They would like to understand your views as to how to respond to IRDAI in this critical situation. Please advise carefully. What they are saying? IRD has asked them to respond within 7 days. Why this company breached the requirement of IRDA guidelines by having a single auditor for all the divisions and the head office. Now, this insurance company, it says it is a private one. Okay, right. So there is no requirement for the private insurance companies to have any joint auditors or so. Right. So this, there has been no breach of the guidelines and accordingly the management should respond. Accordingly, the management should respond. The management should respond to IRDAI to consider relaxation in respect of the provision for the company as the audit is completed and it would practically be very difficult to complete the entire process within the required timelines. No. The management should, right, the management should, right, respond to IRDAI that this provision is applicable to a company only after 15 years of existence and hence there is no breach. The management should respond to IRDAI that this provision should have been ensured by the auditors and hence they should be held liable for this breach of provisions of the IRDA guidelines. No, right? So all these three options not correct. So which is the correct option? There has been no breach of IRDAI guidelines and accordingly the management should respond. Right? What does it say? Consider relaxation as it is practically very difficult, applicable only after 15 years, auditor should be held liable. It says no. Yes, there is no breach and accordingly the management should respond. Right. And coming finally to the last one. Right. I hope you are listening till now. If you are listening, you are superb. Okay. Right. Shivam and Company LLP is a large firm of chartered accountants based out of Delhi NCR. During the financial year 2019, the firm Shivam and Company got an intimation for peer review on 1st July. The process of peer review got started and completed on 15th of September 2018, right? So July, August and September, so around 75 days, which included an on-site review from 1st August to 16th August. Shivam and Company objected to the time taken by the peer reviewer on on-site. However, as per peer reviewer, the entire review process got completed within 90 days from the date of notifying the firm about its selection for review. Right, so now what they are saying, overall limit is 90 days. The review was completed within less than 90 days. But on-site review has taken 16 days almost in this case. The time for complete review should be completed within 120 days. The time for on-site review should not have extended beyond the, right, should not have extended beyond 10 working days. The time for complete review should be completed within 60 days. The time for on-site review should not have extended beyond the 7 working days, right? So if you've not left the chapter on peer review and quality review an option, and if you've done at least one novel reading or newspaper reading of that chapter, you would have come across this, that on-site review should not extend beyond 7 working days. Right, so on-site review should not extend beyond 7 working days, right? So D is the correct option, right? So 10 more MCQs which we have discussed, okay, right? So thank you very much, and I also wish you all the very best. Yes, thank you.